Thank you. Translation of the Gospel for the 10th Sunday after Pentecost, taken from chapter 18 of St. Luke. There were some who had confidence in themselves, thinking that they had won acceptance with God, and they despised the rest of the world. To them, at this time, Jesus addressed the following parable. Two men went up into the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, the other a publican. The Pharisee stood upright and made this prayer in his heart. I thank thee, God, that I am not like the rest of men, who steal and cheat and commit adultery, or like this publican here. For myself, I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican stood far off. He would not even lift up his eyes towards heaven. He only beat his breast and said, God, be merciful to me. I am a sinner. I tell you, this man went back home higher in God's favor than the other. Everyone who exalts himself shall be humbled, and the man who humbles himself shall be exalted. Thus far the words of today's Holy Gospel. A few brief announcements. One of them is an unfortunate practical announcement. I must unfortunately ask you for the time being, please, to refrain from using the donation boxes at the back of the church. Last week I had them all replaced with very good locks, but apparently not good enough because at some point yesterday somebody has cut through all of them. So please do not use those boxes at the moment. Please also pray for this unknown, misguided person who has committed the sacrilege of stealing God's own house. After the Mass today, or after the tea and coffee, will be the catechism lesson for the confirmation students. There will be about 12:10 or 12:15 after that time to have something to drink in the house. Finally, this Tuesday, the Holy Mass will be at 8 a.m. This Tuesday will not be the noon Mass, it will just be Mass at 8 a.m. Finally, really finally, this Friday is the feast day of our local Lancashire martyrs. A celebration at the cathedral, St. Peter's Cathedral, beginning at 12:15, with a rosary walk to the martyrs' monument and the litany of the Lancaster martyrs. So we have, if we can't go in person, at least on that day, to invoke in particular these martyrs who gave down their life, the true faith, to remain loyal to God's church. And so we pray to them once again for the reconversion of this country and of this region. gospel, had come now to church instead of going to the temple, he might stand up just before receiving Holy Communion and cry out, "Lord, I am worthy to receive you." Put bluntly like that, the Pharisees' position seems so obviously foolish. And yet, the contrast between the prayer of the Pharisee and the prayer of the publican, the detested and dishonest tax collector, gives each of us the opportunity today to examine the nature of our own spiritual life. In a word, our Lord wishes to teach us today that the only authentic basis of our spiritual life is a profound humility. Now, I want to erase from your minds a false notion of humility, which is just a parody of true Christian. True humility is simply the acknowledgement of our real status before God. And in fact, created in the image and likeness of God, we do have a lot to be proud of, proud in the best sense of the word. In the immortal saying of St. Leo the Great, "O Christian, acknowledge your dignity and become a partaker of the divine nature. Refuse to return to the old baseness by degenerate conduct. Remember the head and the body of which you are a member." But here, in this gospel, we almost have the impression that the Pharisee is asking God to thank him, as if he, the Pharisee, is doing God a favor by being so wonderful. His great folly is to think that he himself is the source of the graces he has received. It is true that he is not a thief or an adulterer, but is this simply due to his own efforts, or does it come from a deep love of God and neighbor? In everything that we do, indeed in our very being itself, there are two principles at work: God, who created us, and the nothingness which we were created. And so whatever good we possess or perform really comes from God and not from us. Of course, we have to cooperate with God's grace, but grace is exactly that. Grace, something that is freely given and to which we have no right. Whatever in us is not good, whether it is a serious sin or just a small imperfection, that is what really comes from us. "What hast thou that thou hast not received?" asks St. Paul. "And if thou hast received it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it?" The proud man does not thank God, since he attributes all his religious observance to his own merits, and he does not think to ask God for any favors, not even for the gift of final perseverance, because that would require him to acknowledge his own needfulness. That is why the tax collector went down justified, and the Pharisee did not. It sometimes happens that a person who commits a grave sin, unless his conscience is completely distorted, makes such a fervent act of contrition at seeing his weakness that he ends up advancing in holiness, whereas the lukewarm, who are overconfident in their own merits, slip slowly, slowly into the abyss without even realizing it. And that is why we must ask God for the grace to help see ourselves as we really are in his sight. According to the Psalms, God has had regard to the prayer of the humble, and he has not despised their petition. On the other hand, St. James tells us, "God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble." In other words, the principal thing we need to bring to our prayer is humility. St. Paul warns us, "He that thinketh himself to stand, let him take heed lest he should fall." God withdraws. allows them to fall into sin as the result of their pride is in fact for their own good, for our own good. By allowing Christ to see that, as our Lord said, without me, you can do nothing, God endeavors to bring them back to the right path. That is why our sins should actually help us in our spiritual life. We should, like the publican, learn from our sins and use them to cultivate humility. The religion of the Pharisee, according to Martin Newman, is the religion of the natural man in every age and place. It is often very beautiful on the surface, but it is worthless in God's sight. It is good as far as it goes, but worthless and hopeless because it does not go further, because it is based on self-sufficiency and leads only to self-satisfaction. This parable shows us that appearances can be deceiving. To the eyes of his contemporaries, the Pharisee is a model of piety. The publican seems to be an outcast who ought not really dare even to come into the temple. Are we perhaps also guilty of making rash judgments like this? Do we fall into self-complacency and routine in our religious practices? Or do we animate them with a real sense of contrition and gratitude? Do we pray for the conversion of sinners and non-believers? Or are we content to look down? This lesson, which we should take away from all of this, is what our Lord tells us at the end of today's Gospel. Everyone who exalts himself shall be humbled, and he who humbles himself shall be exalted. In saying this, our Lord shows himself to be truly his mother's son, and we celebrate this month her Immaculate Heart. Remember what our Lady said in her canticle of thanksgiving. He hath put down the mighty from their thrones, and hath exalted the humble. But you will notice that there is no slavish false humility in Mary's Magnificat. He that is mighty hath done great things for me. But why, Mary? Because he hath regarded the humility of his handmaid. Let us therefore ask Mary today to obtain for us the blessing of true humility, combined with gratitude for God's grace and a fruitful sorrow for our sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.